Hello. Firstly, my sincere thanks to the organising committee of the conference. It's a great honour to speak today. This afternoon, my topic is the introduction of the potter's wheel in ancient Sudan, also known as ancient Nubia or Kush. As yet, the impact of the potter's wheel in Sudan has been little studied. Sudanese potters had arguably little use for the potter's wheel, as they had a well-developed hand-making pottery traditions, firing their pots in pits or clamp kilns. The Egyptians perhaps brought the potter's wheel to Sudan, and in today's talk I would like to consider, firstly, did the indigenous Sudanese potters ever use the potter's wheel to make their pots? Two, did the Egyptians control the use of the potter's wheel and or access to thrown pottery? Thirdly, was wheel thrown pottery an elite item in Sudan? Fourthly, how did the blending of manufacturing techniques take place, if at all? So the potter's wheel came to Egypt before Sudan, during Egypt's fourth dynasty around 2600 BC. The invention originating in the Near East around 4000 to 3000 BC. How this occurred and developed was the topic of my PhD research, now published as The Origins and Use of the Potter's Wheel in Ancient Egypt with Archaeopress in 2015. It's quite hard to summarise this work in just one slide, but for the purpose of this paper, I'll do my best. So, after one or two false starts, the Egyptians adopted the invention of the potter's wheel from Near Eastern potters during the reign of Pharaoh Seti, the father of Khufu or Cheops, around 2600 BC. Levantine potters had been using the wheel to delicately thin and finish coil-built vessels, as seen in Tel Yarmouth in Israel. However, from the beginning, the Egyptians utilised the wheel to throw vessels off the hump of clay rather than finish a coil-built vessel. They started off small in the same manner as apprentice potters do, making miniature offering pots about 7 to 8 centimetres in height, so really quite small. Interestingly, these potters appear to have been state-sponsored, as the first wheel-thrown vessels occur solely in elite cemetery sites and are encountered in all the Great Pyramid sites, including Giza. Despite the introduction of the potter's wheel from the 4th dynasty for producing miniature vessels, other techniques of hand-building were not forgotten. Beer jars were made through coiling clay together, and bread moulds were formed over a core or patrix. Jars, bowls and plates continued to be coiled built until the first intermediate period, around 2181 to 2025 BC. After this point, almost all pottery types, with the exception of coarse wares, bread moulds and large amphorae, were thrown on the wheel. The Egyptians threw pottery using both Nile silt clays gathered from the edge of the Nile and marl clays mined from the desert regions, mostly to the east. From about 2000 BC, the Egyptians began a military campaign to conquer Nubia, eager to own the gold mines and other wealth that the Nubians possessed. The Egyptians conquered Lower Nubia and the entire reach between the first and second cataracts of the Nile at the beginning of the Middle Kingdom, around 2050 to 1710 BC. However, just as a caveat, one shouldn't consider Nubia as a one culture, but as various Nubias, each with different social structures and different approaches to adapting and adopting Egyptian colonization and the associated goods. These various Nubias was perhaps why an impressive series of 13 Egyptian fortresses, you can see some of them in the map just below me, was completed during the reign of Pharaoh Sinwasrit III around 1850 BC. The completion probably with the construction of the fortresses at Urinarti, just in the inset here, located on an island in the middle of the Nile, and Ascut. Initially, these were staffed by rotating military garrisons. However, later changes in the architecture of these fortresses, the introduction of domestic Nubian pottery and the appearance of elite tombs and stelae demonstrated that the Egyptian occupation shifted to a more permanent settlement in more self-sufficient communities at the end of the 12th dynasty. So how did this colonization affect the indigenous Nubian cultures and the indigenous Nubian pottery? Well, Nubian pottery by this period was already extremely highly sophisticated, using delicate hand building techniques and firing styles that had mostly been abandoned by the Egyptians about 100 to 1,000 years earlier. Two contemporary groups were occupying areas of Nubia in this period. What is known as the C group in Lower Nubia, which was colonized or affected by the Egyptians in about 2000 BC. Another culture known as the Kerman Nubians, which were independent of Egypt until about 1500 BC. The construction of these sort of vessels was via paddle and anvil technique and coil built vessels. These were often really highly burnished and polished and decorated, and they utilised Nile clay from a mixture of sources and different recipes. The firing was done in open fires or pits, and the potters were really extremely skillful in utilising the oxidising and reduction conditions of their pit fires. I have undertaken experiments to replicate the sort of silver lines that you can see in the Kerma period pottery, as I'm indicating here. And early experiments indicate the use of hematite, which is a white pigment, which I think was applied as a slip or a paste to the outside of the vessel. And that created this beautiful silver to black banding effect during firing when it reacted with the clay, leaving this beautiful coloration. This technique was never replicated by the ancient Egyptians and shows a really high level skill on the part of the Sudanese potters. So arguably, with such incredible pottery already being made in Sudan, they perhaps didn't really need the potter's wheel. And perhaps that was why that the indigenous potters didn't take it on or adopt it from the ancient Egyptians. By contrast, the wheel thrown pottery from Egyptian areas was really quite bland in a way. So the typical wheel thrown pot from Egypt was all wheel thrown by about 2000 BC, and it utilized Nile and desert marl clays, usually in a homogeneous recipe of both, for i.e. gathered from one source. The Egyptians brought their pottery during military campaigns to their fortresses and their new colonies. The presence of pottery made from marl clays that were originating from the eastern deserts of Egypt implies that the ceramic vessels were regularly being imported from Egyptian workshops in both Upper and Lower Egypt. And then over time, colonies were found to have a mixture of Nubian and Egyptian pottery. One such colony is Amara West. Amara West was the administrative capital of Upper Nubia during Egypt's 19th to 25th dynasty, which corresponds to about 1550 to 656 BC. The site is located on the west bank of the Nile between the second and third cataracts in northern Sudan. It has until recently been excavated by teams from the British Museum, and I was lucky enough to be part of the team during the 2013 season. It's a large mud-bricked walled garrison town, which consists of densely packed mud-brick buildings, including large-scale storage places, houses of various sizes, from small as 50 to 500 metres squared, and other structures of unclear function. At this site, there's an intriguing blend of Egyptian and Nubian cultures beginning. You regularly start to find Nubian cooking pots alongside Egyptian vessels, particularly Egyptian storage vessels, within domestic settings. They also occur in the funerary pyramids and tombs in a sort of interesting blend of objects. These colonies also have some examples of kilns and Nile silt wasters, but pottery workshops are relatively rare. So this begs the question, did the Egyptians control access to their pottery? It appears that the Egyptians were interested in producing self-sufficient colonies in Sudan, as well as acculturated indigenous groups, including pottery industries. Petrographic analysis of the clays utilized by Nubian and Egyptian pottery demonstrates that the Nubian clays came from mixed sources, whereas the Egyptian pots were more homogeneous. The diversity of chemical signatures from the Nubian pottery suggests that these pots were being made on a smaller scale than the Egyptian, likely by part-time potters who were exploiting a wide range of clay sources. Producing Egyptian-style throne vessels required the mastering of an entirely new skill, utilising the potter's wheel, one which can take up to about 10 years to be truly proficient in. And the potter's wheels can also be extremely heavy, with most bearing stones weighing between 3 and 7 kilograms. And transporting these around would have been difficult. So the beginnings to bring the potter's wheel, in effect, would present some barriers, and learning the skills to be proficient enough to use the wheel, make the vessels required by the colonies, would have taken time to train indigenous Nubian potters. So we presume that it is Egyptian potters moving south with their wheels, and then that later disseminates into the wider Nubian landscape. So producing Egyptian-style throne vessels would require this entirely new object, the potter's wheel. So dynastic potter's wheel bearings are very similar to those known across the Levant and the Middle East. They comprise a socket and pivot of stone. In the Egyptian case, this is usually limestone, granodiorite, or basalt, or a combination as seen in the British Museum example below. The socket would have been buried into the ground and a wheel head of unfired clay, wood, or terracotta attached to the top of the pivot. The potter would have spun it with one hand and thrown pottery with the other. The concept of the potter's wheel was borrowed from their Levantine neighbours around 2600 BC and was gradually introduced to Egyptian potters. Early wheel-thrown pottery was produced exclusively for elite funerary sites, as we've seen in previous slides, but the repertoires were gradually expanded until almost all pottery vessels were thrown on the wheel by about 2100 BC in Egypt. By bringing this new technology to Sudan, the Egyptians were in effect stamping their objects and culture and technologies upon these new colonies. Another question to consider was, when did the potter's wheel come to be used in Sudan other than just via Egyptian imported throne pottery? Some evidence comes from the clays used in Sudan. So-called gilded wares are covered with a micaceous or muscovite slip on both sides, giving the sherd a sort of golden appearance. An example comes from the Egyptian colony of Sai, as you can see in this slide. This small fragment, measuring about 3.1 by 3 centimetres of a thin-walled jar with a flaring rim made in a very fine Nile silt clay, was found in material below the foundations of a large house, house number 55. It's covered with a micaceous slip on both sides, giving it this golden appearance. It's quite interesting that the potters were creating quite standard Egyptian wheel-thrown jars in Nile silt, but adding a local twist by slipping it with the micaceous slip. Such fragments were produced in the second cataract forts recently restudied by Christian Knobloch. These would have been produced by potters working in these Egyptian forts, presumably having brought Egyptian potter's wheel bearings with them. Micaceous rich clays are an interesting choice, as the use of mica is good for creating hard, durable vessels which are resistant to thermal shock. However, the Egyptian potters working in Sudan seem to have recognised that these mica-rich clays are also unsuitable for long-term liquid storage, as the vessels tended to fall apart. They appear to have used these mica-rich clays for making tablewares rather than cooking pots. For example, things like globular jars, cups, bowls, spouted vessels with applied animal motifs. This really rare wheel-made Nile clay was locally produced in Lower Nubia during the late Middle Kingdom to Second Intermediate period. So I'm talking about 1782 to 1500 BC, but stopped being created very shortly afterwards. Interestingly, in modern Sudan, potters at Sai now use micaceous clay, so the technology is continuing. So what about pottery workshops, about pottery sites? Well, unfortunately, potters' workshops are extremely rare in both Egypt and Sudan, and evidence of potter wheel bearings are even more so. A really rare example of a clay wheel head has recently been recognised and published by Stuart Tyson Smith in 2014, from the Egyptian fortress of Ascut, dating to around 1850 BC. It was discovered within a storehouse complex, perhaps suggesting state control of the production of pottery craft. Interestingly, it's made of fired terracotta and in quite an unusual shape, with finger holes for the wheel, you can see those here, to be attached to the pivot with wet clay. It was probably designed for the mushroom-headed shaped pivot stones, as you can see this example from the Cairo Museum. The wheel head side measured 42 centimetres in diameter, much smaller than those thought by experimental potter Catherine Powell in 1995 and my own experiences to be useful for throwing. In her experiments, Powell determined that around 70 to 75 centimetre diameter unfired clay wheel heads worked the best, similar to an example uncovered at the site of Abu Sir in Egypt. In my own experimental reconstructions, you can see a sort of a picture there, I used modern wooden wheel head of a similar size, which also worked well. But with this new example from Stuart Tyson Smith at Ascot, we can add terracotta to the repertoire for wheel heads. In 1977, Rotislav Holthor published a Middle Kingdom period pottery workshop, which also may have contained a wheel. This site number 228, dated to 1850 BC, a contemporary site to Ascot, discovered by the Scandinavian joint expedition to Sudan in the 1960s as part of the Aswan Haido Dam archaeology rescue missions. It was found within room 7. It was a pivot located near the east wall, lubricated with black resin. The wheel was located in a workshop which featured a kiln, two small drying bins, and an area with dung and straw probably used for the kiln. Unfortunately, there doesn't appear to have been any published photographs or drawings of the wheel bearings, but this is still a really interesting sight. All of the pottery sherds uncovered here were wheel thrown, with the exception of one complete hand-built cup. So it's more than likely that this is a wheel throwing pottery workshop located next to Nubian sites. The often distinctive pottery traditions of Bronze Age Kush or Nubia seem to have been at least temporarily disrupted during the later second millennium BC, one legacy of Egypt's southward expansion during the New Kingdom. A lack of archaeologically recognisable and indigenous ceramic cultures over subsequent centuries is in itself of interest, a condition which seems to persist throughout the first half of the first millennium BC. In turn, most of what we encounter in what's later termed Napatan pottery draws heavily on Egyptian pottery techniques and repertoires. However, in the Meriotic period, these were to change markedly with the appearance of what is in fact often quite new types of pottery. These may look to both internal Sudanic and external Mediterranean traditions, in turn relating to a number of distinct modes of productions and technologies. We know that gradually Egyptian rule weakened in Sudan, and by the 11th century BC, the Egyptians withdrew and the fortresses were largely abandoned. The site of Meroe, which was located between the 5th and 6th cataracts of the Nile, had become the new capital of the Kushite state by about 270 BC. During this Meriotic period, as it came to be known, Kushite culture showed less Egyptian influence and increasingly displayed a more Nubian character. This included the worship of new local deities and the creation of a Meriotic alphabet. The rule of Meroe's kings extended hundreds of miles to the south, and most of northern Nubia between the first and second cataracts became part of the Meriotic Empire. The Egyptian style potter's wheel was apparently one of the items which stayed the course. At the site of Muzawarat Asafra, a pottery workshop including a wheel was discovered in 1965, but reanalysed in 1997 by David Edwards from Leicester University. Muzawarat Asafra is situated about 180 kilometres northeast of Sudan's modern capital Khartoum, 25 kilometres outside of the Nile Valley in the semi-arid landscape of the Karaba. The recovery of substantial quantities of finely decorated Chalcolithic finewares, apparently the remains of manufacturing failures, a significant body of other material relating to pottery manufacturing, including this granite potter's wheel, as you can see up here, was identified. In addition, a substantial body of other pottery, much of it thought likely to be locally made, provided valuable new insights into the ceramic culture associated with this very special site. The pottery workshop was located just within what is known as the Great Enclosure, in a small room at the very edge of the walled enclosure, just here, encircled here. At the same point, there was a wide variety of handmade ware circulating, particularly in domestic settings, whereas the wheel-thrown fine wares were rarer. This may suggest that the potter's wheel, such as found at this site, was regarded as a more urban specialism, perhaps as a royal monopoly in the same way as ironworkers were considered. So to sum up, this paper represents a really tentative beginning to unpick the development of the use of the potter's wheel in Sudan, and perhaps its forced adoption by the invading Egyptians from around 2000 BC. When the Egyptians set up their colonies, they brought everything that they needed with them, including craftspeople such as potters. However, this was not all one-sided. It should be considered a blending of the two cultures in the colony sites, albeit with the Egyptians dominant. Most Egyptian sites contain a mixture of pottery techniques, particularly Nubian handmade cooking pots sitting alongside Egyptian wheel-thrown jars and other vessels. The elites, for example, had no problem having Sudanese-style bucrania surrounding their tombs, but filling them with Egyptian objects. We see that once the Egyptians left, the Sudanese set about utilising these Egyptian technologies, but creating their own magnificent indigenous pottery in the Meroitic period. And interestingly, the kick wheel is now in use in Sudan, the same as it is for Egypt, but this topic is probably for another talk. So to sum up, this is really the beginning of my understanding of the particular manner of Sudanese pottery workshop production and the use of the potter's wheel. As ever, more work is needed, but thank you very much for listening.